Hi, I'm Dr. Selina Matthews, spiritual psychologist. Welcome to Soul Transformation. My guest today is Dr. Dennis Slattery. He is an emeritus professor, scholar, author, and poet. Our topic today is the myth of belief. Why do we believe? What is truth? What is fact? And how do we even know, with all the misinformation and disinformation in our American culture right now, what we should even believe? This is going to be an exciting show where we explore all of these ideas. So stay tuned. I am so very excited to talk to you, Dr. Slattery, on such an exciting topic. Oh my God. So the first question I'm going to start right off the bat is, why do we believe in anything?
Yeah. So it's a powerful question, as all of yours are, that you sent me to consider. Just a little preamble before I respond to that, just to let the audience know, it was around April of 2020 during COVID that the deluge of misinformation began to flood the airwaves. And I asked myself, what is the connection here between what we're supposed to believe and this COVID epidemic? Are these two sides of the same phenomenon? So I began to ask myself, what is mythic about believing? And is there such a critter as a mythology of belief? And that really launched me, Selina, into trying to understand not only beliefs, but assumptions, prejudices, hunches, yearnings, because we're in an era when yearning to believe something is as powerful as believing something in fact. So I'm fascinated by the psychic tectonic plates shifting in America, but I think it's global. But for maybe this discussion, we'll stay in our country.
I think that's a good idea.
Unless we have 4.5 hours, which we don't. So. But I I've taken some notes, and I'm going to read some of it too, because I can't hold it in my head and I can't be quite as articulate. But it seems that we want to believe or have to believe in something because of a deep hunger within us. And I think it has to do with a hunger for connection. It's a hunger for relationships. It's a hunger for community. And beliefs themselves, I think, offer this connective tissue to be formed between ourselves and others and what they believe. I also think, Selina, that beliefs offer us a baseline, a place from which to launch or move on, as well as a frame by which to process what happens to us. Because it's my belief, and there'll be several of my own beliefs that'll come out here, is that the events that happen to us are in themselves meaningless. They need a story or a narrative to give them, I think, meaning and coherence.
I think you're absolutely correct. I think you're absolutely correct. I think there has to be, without meaning, how can we go forward? It's really important.
Yes. Yes. So what we think about and what we're constantly persuaded to accept or reject is part of the challenge today. And beliefs are also touchstones. That's the third point that I wanted to make, to help us keep in touch with ourselves, because I think the self-alienation archetype is rampant now, and it's showing itself, I think, in these horrific assassinations and explosions of violence. I think they have to do with a disassociation from who one is and what one is.
So can you explain more about the myth of alienation? Can you just expand on that? Because that's a really exciting kind of an idea that you have here.
You know, I got so excited. Thank you for that. I got so excited about this topic as a undergrad and then a grad student at Kent State University at a time when existentialism was really front and center. And it was Sartre and Camus and other French nihilists, French deists, and not just in France. But it came to me, they're touching on something that I feel in me as a 22-year-old, 21-year-old, deeply studious, wanting to learn to be contemplative, and really not having a sense of who and what I was at the time, much less what I wanted to do with my life. I thought, geez, maybe I can just read books and Sandy can work and I can live that way. And of course, that bubble burst, and gladly, it's part of why we're still married. But I became fascinated with the aliens, the alien within, the alien, the stranger that's within, that comes up, as I understood it then, through dreams, through fantasies, and through a lot of anxiety. I was an anxious human being for decades, and that has to do with coming out of a violent alcoholic household where we were always on alert for the first dishes to break when my father would begin to flip out, usually by Saturday afternoon. But it was horrendous, and it went on for decades. And we were all imprinted with this sense of uncertainty, which is the baseline for me for what anxiety feeds off of. So that alienation conversation and thesis in literature and philosophy just came home to me, and it's part of why I decided to major in literature and not in psychology, because I was getting, from reading Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, a work that changed my life as a 21-year-old. I thought, this is what alienation looks like. And what does Raskolnikov do? He violently murders an old pawnbroker. And as he's killing her with his axe that he has strapped in his long coat, Her stepsister, Lizaveta, who is pregnant, walks in and begins to slide in the sticky blood on the floor of this little apartment. And Raskolnikov, without even thinking, takes the blunt side of the axe and cracks her skull open. Now he's murdered three. And now begins his redemption. But it took that violent outburst from a young man mythically disassociated from himself. And I'm stealing that line from Joseph Campbell, an entire culture can become mythically disassociated from itself. And then violence is often what moves in to fill that vacuum.
Yeah. So do you think that is what's happening in our American culture right now?
I think it's returned, and it's complicated, of course, by social media, which accelerates and exaggerates everything. But it also shows itself in this sense of estrangement. So to your word, malignancy, I want to add my word, estrangement, and how becoming estranged and seeking to be reconnected with oneself may have as one of its avenues malignant behavior. And that's a speculation on my part, and I know you could speak to it much more eloquently and psychologically. But I think one of the points that I brought that estrangement up and that alienation is that reading about it began to knit something in me back into place.
Wow.
In other words, I had to read about violence and murder and wrong-headed thinking. And with Raskolnikov, the Napoleonic complex that he carried within him. And he thought it was a virtue. And in fact, it was slowly assassinating him. And then the beautiful irony in Dostoevsky's novel is that his redemption is furthered by an 18-year-old prostitute, Sonia Marmeladov, who sells her body to earn rubles, to pay for food, to feed her consumptive mother, her young sister, and her drunken father. And so here she sacrifices everything in order for them to live. And when Raskolnikov's imagination takes that in, he truly begins to listen to her. But Dostoevsky seems to be suggesting, and this is, I think, taking us back, but that movement through violence was somehow morally necessary. I'm not trying to justify it, but it was for Dante finally in the Divine Comedy to come to the base of Mount Purgatory and travel up it in community. And then with Beatrice Portinari's assistance, moves through the planets through Paradiso. He first had to descend into the depths of malignancy. I'm going to borrow your word right here. In order to experience what it looks like for a soul now in the state of souls after death, which is where the entire poem takes place, continue their self-alienation, self-castigation, and self-violation of the tenets of the church and the seven called deadly sins, seven dysfunctions, the seven abnormal behaviors. He had to go that way first, Virgil tells him, before he can spiral up into the realm of hope, because Inferno is hopeless. And he has to enter that hopelessness. And even as I'm talking to you about these literary works, I'm hearing in my head analogies with some of these figures who have done these horrific killings. It's their passage through Inferno, but they have no guide. You see, Dante had Virgil, the classical poet, who when Dante would get stuck, Virgil would tell him, look, you're spending too much time with these souls. Let's move on. But I think if Dante had gone into the infernal realm without Virgil, he'd still be there.
Wow.
He'd still be in that infernal realm.
Wow.
Yeah. And I know I'm jumping to the end of our conversation, but one of the things that I want to propose in hope is that what would it be like to bring these classics of literature into the psychological field of these young students to give them by analogy both the violence and the descent, but also some form of a resurrection into wholeness, or where the pieces start being put back together. That's one of my hopes.
No, I definitely, I agree with you that I think there has to be, we have to go to the dark side in order to really understand what the light is and psychological health. I mean, people who come to me, a lot of them are really sick psychologically. Not all. I mean, people come for different reasons. But, you know, some people are, you know, have lived their life completely unconscious. And, yes. and you know, we read stories of the Walking Dead, and I see it. God bless them. They are in my practice, and they're finally there after 60 or 70 years of not being awake, but they're starting to wake up. And the bottom line is they are changed. They're making change in their life. And that's the most rewarding thing for me, where they can move out of the dark aspects of their life into something more positive. And so, as you talked about your families, the dysfunction there, my dysfunction in my family, their dysfunction in their families, that all got constellated and created who they were. And that's like, that became their belief system on how to live, because they didn't have other mentors or teachers or professors, or didn't, you know, experience literature in the way that it moved you. They didn't have any of that. They didn't have a guide. And so many people, and I agree with you, are guideless because there aren't enough people stepping up.
Yes.
To be mentors. And I'm a real proponent, mentors, guides, whatever word you want to use, that all of us need to have many people that we help to grow, because they can't all come to therapy, you know, really. And some don't need to, but they just need guides, and they need hope, and they need to change their belief system, because their belief system, the fundamental aspect of their belief system, was flawed. And then you spend your whole life having to recover from the flaws. Am I right?
No, you're telling my story, and millions of others. You're telling absolutely. All of our stories.
Yeah, my story, your story. I mean, you know, when you have dark stuff going on in your childhood, you either go there and you play that same tape, or you find, I found guides. Thank God I found spiritual guides, spiritual people that took me under their wings and moved me out of my family. I am deeply grateful. You found literature. I mean, it doesn't matter how we do it. It matters that we get inspired to do it.
Yes. No, beautifully said. And to add to it, because here's another, maybe it's a paradox rather than an irony. When I was growing up, I paid my own high school tuition to a Catholic Marianist high school in Cleveland, bought my own cars, bought my own food, working at the supermarkets. When I'd come home on Saturday night after 12 hours at the supermarket, my father would lay into me saying, "You worthless, you're worthless, you'll never amount to anything, you stink." He was talking about himself, but I didn't have the psychological tools to understand that. Because he was my father and carried that archetypal power, even as an alcoholic, I believed him.
Yeah.
And we all did. My brother.
We all did. We all did. I did too. I had the same story. We believed it because we thought we weren't, there was something the matter with us. And we spent our entire lives trying to find our authentic self that was beaten out of us at that time, correct? And it's a life. Right. It's a life's work to work at that. I mean, it's not. People go, I went to therapy for 6 months. I'm like, wow, you don't even get started till you go in at 6 months. You're barely taking the history at 6 months. I mean, you know, it's a whole other deal.
Yes. And I wanted to share with you, absolutely right. And I wanted to share with you that the paradox was that when I began at a junior college in Cleveland, which was brand new, it was the first community college in the state of Ohio. They followed California's wonderful models and they migrated it over. In the second semester, a psychiatrist, Blake Kreider, I can't believe this, 60-some years after, I can remember his name, and he had a practice downtown Cleveland, and he would walk over to the community college and teach because he was good at it and he loved it. And it got him out of the consulting room and so forth. So he offered a course on the psychopathology of everyday life. And I was drawn to the title of the course, Selina, with a power I could not have ever resisted. So here's my father's pathology that then flips to guide me to psychology's exploration of the pathology of the psyche. And I thought, this would never have happened, and that course title would have never excited me, except that I knew that I was pathological in me, shaped by beliefs, and I want to say that shame is a belief. In other words, shame was a dominant force field, and I think these emotions are parts of belief systems. Maybe we choose a different word from belief. But I believed in myself shamefully. I'm just trying to give a sentence to capturing. It was a worldview. My shame was a worldview.
Yeah, it was. You were set up. You were set up by your parent or parents, I don't know your story, but by your father for sure, to not be fully yourself. So
exactly.
That belief, it was actually a belief that was set up in you, a personal belief set up by your family that you then had to carry throughout life until you found these different ways of moving. So you just interfaced the personal with the community. And I really like that because your personal belief system got shifted through the community by going to that class. Yes. And then that was a smaller community, and then you had the bigger community at large. So, so how did, at that time in your life, did the larger cultural community affect you in those ways?
Yeah, so one of the questions you posed, and you've just reframed it, which is beautiful, how our beliefs are formed, and then personally and culturally. And here's my response that I had reflected on. Certainly from our own histories, and that's what we've been interrogating here for a few minutes, which will include what we've been taught to believe and what seems, that word seems is so important, what seems to assist us in negotiating what I'm calling the inner cosmos of our lives with the transitory elements of the family, culture, civilization that we may explore. Our beliefs are also, and this is spiraling back, our beliefs are also deformed. Our beliefs are also misinformed by forces that are destructive, demeaning, shaming, which can originate from within us and from outside forces seeking to control and manage us along certain biases. From these and other sources, patterns of apprehension and comprehension are formed and over time may continue to serve us or are in need of radical revision. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's so super clearly said. You know, I think you integrated all of your family, set up your belief system, and from which then there's the beliefs that take form. I'm going to go to a different question now. The beliefs that take form, you have replaced that. You have deleted the yes. old beliefs and you have replaced them. So our belief systems are capable of change because of one, new information, because of education, because of literature, because of psychology, therapy, from a lot of different things. So can you speak more about that?
Yes. And to add to what you just said, it's so important that in particular situations, facts are buried or demeaned or trivialized or deflected in order that this other belief system can be formed and put in place. So you had also asked in that question, do we sometimes need to use a periodically a reset button? And I like that image. I like that image of resetting things, recalibrating, backing up and maybe cleaning house a bit, emotionally and otherwise. And I said to myself, I wrote to myself, amen to your question. If a myth with its belief infrastructure, and I believe that beliefs are the infrastructure of our mythologies, is if it's truly organic and living, then it not only withstands, but actually encourages revisions and amplifications that grow over time. Without this reset, I continued to push this, one can become caught in a complex that freezes one's freedom and robs the person of their dignity, as well as their purpose in life. But this takes a person who is able to reflect and to see within and to have the courage to cultivate one's own integrity. We learn through our belief systems. They act like a filtration system. I thought this metaphor might work, that our belief systems can act like a filtration system. Their wire mesh allows certain things to pass through while it filters others out. Our belief systems may also be thought of as methods by which we grasp reality on a daily basis. In other words, our mythology is our methodology. It's a method for apprehending, for understanding, for interpreting, for discovering meaning, that without these reflective capacities, things feel like discrete. One happens, another event happens, another event happens, and no coherent narrative has a chance to coagulate and start forming. Just another line. When these beliefs go underground, out of consciousness, then I think they become assumptions that while underground affect our way of being in the world. Last point, our beliefs may become so entrenched that they become our gods and goddesses. The point that resiliency and pliability, to the point that resiliency and pliability can disappear from our lexicon. We stop speaking with a sense of a certain emotional plasticity, that things still have movement. They haven't hardened into a shape that may be formed, may be deformed, but that's our belief.
Yeah, absolutely. I loved your analogy of the infiltration system. I think our moral code is in there somewhere, in our belief systems hold our morality. What do you think?
Yes. Yeah, because our morals are another form of the filtration system. Mm-hmm. And by means of it, we can judge, know, That's unfair. That's unjust. If we're amoral, then we may put in place, well, what's important here is profit. What is important here is power. And then everything gets flattened out on that very thin bed. And any moral discernment is seen as without value. And that's where chaos wears a white shirt and a tie and looks respectable. But underneath it is a form of the demonic.
Yeah, I would absolutely agree with you. I would definitely agree with you. I want to move on to something else right now. Sure. I want to talk about truth. Truth is complicated. Is truth really truth? Or is truth a projection of fantasy? I mean, our culture is going through a lot of that right now. We don't even know what's true anymore. We don't know what to believe, who to believe, what political party is telling the truth. Everything is got alternative facts, misinformation, disinformation, and everything else under the sun that I'm not saying.
Yes. No, it's huge. It's huge what you're posing. Truth is complicated. And as you asked me now and earlier, is what is true actually 100% true? Or can it be partially true? Or can it be a fantasy projection of what one wants the truth to be? And I say yes to all three. Mm-hmm. Yes to all three. An individual can hold a belief seemingly true way past its being proved inadequate, outdated, or no longer viable. But in some of the reading that I've done, and if we pay attention to the news and some of the commentaries, we've reached a place. I think we're beyond a brave new world in 1984. I think a new novel, epic, has to be written that takes some of the basic insights of Huxley and Orwell, but pushes it further into the techno realm that we're in now of social media. We're at a place now, Selina, where even my wish that something be true overrides all other concerns. In other words, it's a kind of wish fulfillment that this is true. And in that wishing, it becomes, in fact, true for that person, for that tribe, for that entity. I wanted to say something else here, too. But one's own sense of what is real can become an illusion when clung to without any further reflection. And this movement, well, we're very much an extroverted people. It's all about out there doing, not very much about in here contemplating. And Jung, in the beginning pages of Psychology and Alchemy, which I've begun rereading, that volume has just called me back to it. He says, you know, the man in the street thinks he knows psychology. And it's, you know, kind of trivial. And I mean, but there's no interior movement in that person, because any movement is always externalized. It's pushed into the world. And part of my hope, I'm going to give you a second one, is that in the school systems, and some schools are doing things with yoga and reflection and meditation, in the early grades, to give them a sense of being centered in themselves and to cultivate a reflective attitude, where sometimes silence can be the most effective teacher, not information being poured into them all the time. And this is also true for the adult world, but I think hope is going to reside in what we develop with the younger people that comes up as habits of thinking and habits of being.
Well, it has to. They are our future. We have to put all of our energy into the youth and developing them in ways that we have never imagined, because it's that part that we never imagined they need to imagine. So we need to put them into not only yoga, creativity, all kinds of unordinary, healthy things, because the new world order, whatever that is, you and I can't see it yet. They will be living it. You and I will be gone. So, that and a whole lot more that I don't even know. I don't have words to articulate it. Yeah, I 1,000% agree with you. Yes, they are our future.
And you know, thank you for that. And one other area with us living longer is that we become mentors to them. That's outside of the teacher's role. I'm thinking that if one is one's teacher, one of course can be one's mentor, but I think a mentor has some other qualities that that age brings, a certain wisdom, a certain ripening brings that. I mean, just, you know, Eleanor and Sienna, 10 and 5, when we go over there to visit them or they come over here, it's golden time and they're interested in how we think about things and they want to show us. And what do you think about this, Papa? I mean, they're yearning, and their parents are golden, but we're not talking about their parents. We're talking about their parents' parents. And I think we're a whole underutilized population that could be on a volunteer basis and with a structure enormously enriching for the younger folks.
Yeah. I can't agree with you more. And I do that in my own life. I mentor people. That's important to me, but we need lots of people to do that, and there aren't enough, and that's an incredible point. I want to move on because we're going through a lot of time here. I want to talk about the weaponization of beliefs. Can they be weaponized?
Yeah.
And can you give me an example of weaponizing beliefs?
Yeah, that was a really good. I mean, all of the questions you posed were just terrific. And yes, here's my response. In the recent massacre of the Uvalde students and teachers, a solution to the problem is to have more teachers and others armed with more weapons as a deterrent. And I think that's weaponizing weapons. Another form of it. I think this absurd solution avoids all responsibility and weaponizes weapons as a solution that is, in fact, patently absurd. Now, I'm allowing my own beliefs to surface here, and I acknowledge that. A friend just in the last 2 days shared with me that her daughter, who teaches 4, 5, and 6-year-olds, has been mandated by the superintendent of the school system she teaches in to begin going to the gun range and taking firing practice to learn how to be comfortable around a pistol and then to have that pistol in her classroom starting in the fall.
I'm horrified. That horrifies me. That is that is such a pathological perspective, or in terms of my belief system, because certainly people are going to disagree with you and me, but that is just horrifying that an educational system needs to be weaponized in order to educate. Yes. So the kids feel unsafe to learn. I mean, all of that, you know, has resounding efforts in George Orwell's 1984 is Newspeak, his, you know, version of Newspeak, and let's, you know, limit the vocabulary and let's take over. But what that's also saying to me, Dennis, is that the amount of narcissism culturally is so out of control that the people in powerful places tend to be narcissists. And as I was preparing for this, I read something about what Plato said. He said something like, I'm going to paraphrase this because I can't remember exactly. Plato said that he thought all people that work in the government kind of systems need to be philosophers. Philosophers that are tried and over, and they make the right decisions for the community. What I'm seeing is that people in our political parties, and I'm not putting one or against the other, in there's people in both sides that are narcissistic and malignant. And there's some good people and there's a combination. But this, our world would be completely different if philosophers ran the country versus attorneys. I don't know. What do you think?
No, absolutely. Because the knowledge base from somebody who can think philosophically, and the idea of philosophia is somebody who loves the pursuit of wisdom. We're not getting a whole lot of that because wisdom has been displaced by political agendas. And part of what I am so concerned about is the continual reducing of us as human beings to politically inclined consumers who go with us, them. I mean, Selina, the fractured imagination that is creating this is it's a dead end, and I hesitated to use that term, but I use it figuratively and literally. So yes, Plato's Republic sees the value of the philosophically minded, and you know, those universities across the country, colleges, that have presidents or higher ups that have degrees in literature, philosophy, psychology, not businessmen, not administrators, have a vision for their schools that you can tell this is not doing business in the ordinary way. Schools that insist that students take 9 hours of philosophy as an undergraduate, regardless of what they're going to head out to, because they know the value of that kind of hunger that is satisfied only by true knowing.
Correct.
And so it's no longer about your credentials. It's about the nature of the soul that you've developed and been influenced positively by others, even if it's a philosopher whose point of view you are not ready to accept. Well, there's a perfect opportunity to use that as traction for what you do believe with opposition coming at you. But that's the other, one of my other fears is that parents say, I don't want my children reading Toni Morrison's The Bluest Eye or Beloved. He can't sleep at night. I think that's their projections more often than not.
I can't agree with you more. I'm totally with you on that. Absolutely. The unconscious, their inability to process their own issues with race and gender and all of that, those aspects that go in that world is horrifying, because I I see the limits in my practice in some people, and also in people that I know out in the world. It's horrifying. Again, I'm using that word again. It's horrifying, and we have to change that. I want to move on to question number 9 that I have, because I'm going to go to that one. In America today,
this is a good one.
We have all kinds of fabrication. We have the big lie. We have the Holocaust deniers. I mean, what are we doing as a culture to deal with this? What is happening here in our culture when we can't even believe proven facts? And this is, I was reading some kind of report, something like 30% or 35%, I don't quote me on this one, but 35% of people I forget, but anyway, it was something like 78% or 75% of Republicans believed that the election was stolen.
Yes.
And I don't have words for that when Republican leaders have said that wasn't true. And yet there's all this fabrication that comes from the media, from friends, from, you know, sports people. I don't even know, from social media, Facebook, Twitter. I don't even know how to put accurate information into the world.
Yeah. Yeah, boy, that's a lot, and it's really good. You know, we've reached a place, and the narcissism that you have brought up a few times in our conversation, narcissism has become so malignant that my desire for what I want to be true trumps, and I'm using that verb consciously, what is true. In other words,
I love it.
Desire trumps your facts that can be proven. That is, you know, Rollo May published Power and Innocence in 1972. I love Rollo May. I love his work. I love the connection of Freudian psychology to literature. He's such a literate man. But he coined the term pseudo-innocence in that book on power and innocence. Yeah, and then Love and Will came 2 years earlier. And he says America is still in its pseudo-innocent posture. And we're still wearing the split from England, 1620, I think John Smith brought over the first group to Plymouth, where now we're done with the past. We're throwing the yoke of oppression of the British off. But May shows, and other writers have subsequently written about, we threw off history itself. And that belief that somehow we're back in Eden, hey, ahistorical, before the fall, carries a lot of energy of the American psyche's mythos. And there's more written on it. I had a book that I was going to show you. Don't need to because of our time. So pseudo-innocence. But now, can I give an example of this? Because I want your audience to know about it. This is a response that's helped me about, do facts anymore speak for themselves? I remember Joe Friday and his partner in Dragnet. That's all he cared about. Remember, he'd move around and somebody would start telling their story. He said, wait a minute, no, the facts, ma'am, just the facts. And that was how he solved cases. So the facticity of things in that period of 1950s or 60s was powerful. But I want to mention a book by a physicist and the president of the University of Dallas for 22 years, and his wife was my mentor. His name is Donald Cowan. In 1988, he wrote a book with a title I think you'll like, Unbinding Prometheus, Education for the Coming Age. And I've gone back after 20 years, 25 years, and I'm rereading it. Early on, he points this out. He writes that the myth of fact has been the prevailing myth of the modern age up until recently. Fair enough. Now, 1988, he published the book. But he then points out an historical move that I found fascinating and I want to share with you that I think may be responsible for the conspiracy theories enjoying a heyday today. He suggests, Donald Cowan suggests, that the myth of fact shifted in the early Renaissance, which he categorizes as 14th century Italy. I'm going to quote him. In it, the observable objects of the world came to exist in their own right. Rather than taking their meaning from a context, which is so critical, in order to participate in a larger reality, facts began to be considered the unchallengeable substance of life. What evolved has, and this is my thinking, what evolved has come down to us as facts speak for themselves. They can be measured and verified and trusted as entities to believe in their own right. But we've entered a different mode of consciousness in our understanding of facts. Fact-checking, never heard the term until a number of years ago, has become necessary to counter the dizzy world of alternative facts. Facts are then weakened in their ability to be believed in. Then, and this is my thinking off of Donald's provocations, then the space between fact and fiction closes even further. When facts lose their contexts, their veracity diminishes. Facts in large measure help us to construct our narratives that shape our identities. But if facts are relativized, which I think is what has happened, so at its core is reality itself. Reality itself is being relativized. If individuals and even whole nations are no longer certain what or who to believe, or to what degree, their identity as a coherent and cohesive body with shared senses of purpose and ideals to pursue are orphaned. So wow. I just wanted to share, because I think Donald Cowan's insight about, and the chapter in the book is called The Myth of Fact. So I just thought a brilliant insight, and he tracks that historically to, and then I pushed it just a bit further, and we have been kind of doing that in unison, that when facticity itself is relativized, so is reality, which then, Selina, opens the box to anything goes. I can say anything about anything. Or in the case of the Buffalo assassin, I can write a 125-page screed, which then gives me the impetus and even the right. Now I'm pushing here. To take other people's lives into my own hands and take their death into my own hands. This is the illogical but mythically understandable outcome of the castration of facts themselves. Yeah.
It's mind-blowing. That is absolutely mind-blowing. Mind-blowing.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to even, you know, comprehend all of that because yes. it's just like, wow. Wow. And yet, I'm going to, in my reading that I did in preparation, There was 2,400 years ago, the Chinese military, I believe it was called Sun Chu or something like that, was using propaganda, misinformation, and disinformation to destabilize his foes, whatever they were, countries or communities. So my question to you is, clearly he was doing that 2,400 years ago. That's really blowing up here. Nothing changes. Nothing changes, Dennis. It's like history is repeating itself. We think this is all new, but this isn't new.
No, you're exactly right. And it spirals back. And as Jung says, you know, in psychic development, you always spiral back to somewhere where you once were, but you land a little bit above it or a little bit below it. You can't, as Thomas Wolfe told us, you can't go home again. But Jung is saying, fair enough, but you can get into the neighborhood where you once were. And there's the house. You can't go home, but you can get into the neighborhood. That's how psychic development is imitating nature's own rich natural cycle. And that's how nature unfurls. Jung says in citing Goethe's botanical writings. So there's that close relationship between nature and psyche's spiralic development. And what you're pointing out is, yes, and the same forms of destabilization. I just finished an essay in The Atlantic on Ukraine and Putin's referring to the Ukrainians as not human beings. They don't measure up. And then we learned from the article that in the 50s, the same thing was leveled at the Ukrainians. You're not even human beings. And so, Selina, what happens when the malformed imagination takes that on, not as a slogan, but as a fact? And Hitler's Germany, and San Francisco. Sorry, please.
Exactly. No, I completely agree with you. I mean, which brings me to this question. This is occurring in our culture right now.
Right now.
And is there hope for our culture?
Yeah.
Is there a myth that can show us the way? What? How are we going to get out of this? Because we are in a quagmire and we're sinking.
Yes. Yes. And the frightening part of your accurate observation is that many seeking power and with it wealth don't any longer seem to care. And that attitude of not caring, I find terrifying. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what do I have? I don't know. I've got some ideas.
I want to hear them. I definitely want to hear them.
Okay. So the first thing, we have to change the attitude, the mindset, on the way that myths are understood. You know, there's not one mythology class in all of public education from the first grade on through. And whether there's a myth class in undergraduate schools is open for discussion. But myths have been understood as lies ever since the Enlightenment that said, imagination, myth, don't trust them. Facts and reason are what you trust. So the slippage there has to make one chortle. The Enlightenment came to that understanding of myth through their own myth, but they forgot they were seeing mythically. In other words, to see that the world is best grasped by science, reason, and quantification, is a mythic stance itself. So one thing to resuscitate in the imagination of the people the value of these wisdom stories that myths give us, because we're still suffering the hangover from the Enlightenment. Let's see here. So also is a need to shift from raging literalism. I think that is another condition that I want to put in your column marked malignancies. Raging literalism that is often at the origin of solutions. And we were talking about that a little while ago. Needed is a new developed sensibility, one with its origins in metaphor, symbol, figural language that opens up possibilities, not forecloses on them. I think that an arrested and anemic imagination is part of the infestation. I think that an arrest, so to see and grasp the world as literal only, not symbolic, a need for a greater emphasis on the humanities and liberal arts learning. For so much of culture's values are passed on in the home and in the schoolroom. Third, maybe, is a need to teach discernment. I think that's different than critical thinking, but yes, that would be another conversation. In how one interprets events, not through the myopic filter of a political point of view that feeds on intolerance, but in the more open Hestian world of focusing. She's the goddess who entertains ideas. She's the goddess of listening. She's the goddess that gathers the community around the hearth fire and exudes hospitality. And only with hospitality can conversations happen. I don't think it can happen without hospitality. To other points of view and a spirit of tolerance and goodwill, our current us-them is a dead end on all fronts, but it is promoted by self-seeking presences that do not have the common good as their beneficiaries. So finally, an emphasis on the intuitive, the imaginal. And I've always loved Jim Hillman's phrase, the poetic basis of mind, that he saw as necessary in healing our fictions. So those are some that I wanted to put out there. And you see, they're all about revamping the educational curriculum to move away from the STEM mode that is all external, and it keeps the inside life of the soul completely out of the curriculum.
Wow. I think that's a, you know, incredible point. And maybe that is where we seek to have hope in development of the children, in these new forms, in these new ways, the development of more mentors in our society, or taking people on, so that we can, you know, if we each take one or two people on, that's a lot of people. You know, and we have to do that. And I think then all of us can contribute towards a better country, more soulful conversations, and onward we go. But this has been an extraordinary conversation. I'm going to give you the last word, Dennis.
Yeah, thank you for that. And I did have something that I wanted to share. And it's just a couple of sentences from a paper that I wrote and delivered called Faith in the World of As If. And I was exploring T.M. Lerman's book, How God Becomes Real. She published it in 2020, and it's just a powerhouse. So I'm going to jump in here. And she uses framing a lot. She uses reality frame and spiritual frames. So this is what I have, or a faith frame. I understand this faith frame. This is my speaking off of her book. I understand this faith frame as a guiding mythology, one that, in the words of popular mythologist Joseph Campbell, can move an individual to a place where they become transparent to the transcendent. Here's what Joe writes in The Inner Reaches of Outer Space. The life of a mythology derives from the vitality of its symbols as metaphors, delivering not simply the idea, but a sense of actual participation in such a realization of transcendence, infinity, and abundance. End quote. And for any of the listeners, that's on Roman numeral 20 at the beginning of the Inner Reaches of Outer Space. So I love that the life of a mythology derives from the vitality of its symbols.
I think that's amazing.
Isn't it? What an insight on his part.
Absolutely. What an incredible insight. And you have been incredibly insightful today. What a beautiful, beautiful discussion this was. We went into so many different areas.
Yes, I love it.
Really, really incredible, very deep. I am deeply, deeply grateful. Thank you, Dr. Slattery. You are amazing. I'm a big fan of yours. You know that. Thank you for being part of the show.